When you look at the Amazon from above, it all looks so lush, so unscathed. But as I scaled a 1,000-foot tower with a climate scientist, we saw storm brewing.
It feels like it's getting closer.
Literally and politically. If just another fifth of the Amazon goes, it could pass an ecological point of no return. From there, the rainforest dries out and burns up forever. But Brazil's president, Jair Bolsonaro, is a climate skeptic who's propped up by the country's powerful agriculture industry. His policies encourage developing large parts of the rainforest with mining, logging, and agriculture. I'm here to meet the scientists who are sounding the alarm for a rainforest in crisis. These are the researchers who've made the Amazon their home and are working around the clock to study a rainforest that's increasingly under threat. They're conducting research in the face of a government that doesn't want to hear the facts. I came to Brazil just a few months before the international community was shocked by images of the rainforest burning, including the same area where I would meet scientists whose groundbreaking research is at risk of losing government funding. Stefan Wolf is an atmospheric scientist. We took a boat deep into the Amazon to the research center where he works. We're headed to the Amazon Tall Tower Observatory. This is a collaboration between the Germans and the Brazilians. It's one of the largest science projects in this country. The Amazon is 55 million years old and home to 390 billion trees. It has served as a carbon sink, able to absorb emissions that trap heat and cause the earth to warm up. Until recently, the forest was taking in the equivalent of all the emissions of every car on the planet and slowing the pace of global warming. But that's no longer the case. Stefan and his team are using data towers to observe how things are changing. ATO is one of these research stations. It's the tallest tower in South America.
This looks like miles and miles of untouched forest.
It actually is. It's completely pristine here.
Yeah. Is that a rare thing for the Amazon basin these days?
Yeah, basically 20% of the Amazon is already destroyed, so this is one example which really strongly shows how important it is to protect it.
Stefan's team uses these structures of varying heights to collect data. We started out on one that was 262 feet tall.
Sensors and readers up here, what kind of information are you getting?
Basically, this is on the one hand meteorological information like humidity, temperature, radiation, that means energy which is coming from the sun.
Now, how tall is the ATO Tower?
It's 325 meters to the top there.
And why does it need to be so tall?
We are not only measuring in one spot of the Amazon rainforest, that's only possible if you go very much higher up than 50 or 80 meters.
With the data from the tower, scientists here have published groundbreaking science, like the first long-term record of how clouds are formed in the Amazon. Those same clouds water crops across South America. They also tracked microparticles of dust that had been carried from the Sahara Desert all the way to the rainforest. In other words, they have shown us just how deeply interconnected the planet's ecosystems are. But scientists here are finding their work increasingly lacking support by the government they rely on for funding.
In the first, we need to have passion to do what we do here. As a scientist, I'm curious.
Bruno Takeshi is the operational manager of the ATO and Amazon FACE, which is a long-term study of how increasing CO2 will affect the rainforest.
One thing that's not so much a mystery is that CO2 levels are rising and we're getting into a planetary danger zone. So really, the big question is, will this forest survive or not?
Exactly. So we are facing this scenario.
As we burn more fossil fuels for energy, atmospheric carbon dioxide rises and drives global temperatures higher.
And which level of the forest is the most sensitive to CO2?
Actually, we have seen that the low level of the forest is the area more sensitive. Of course, the entire forest is sensitive, but especially these small species that react more fast for any kind of changes.
Much of South America depends on Amazonian rain cycles. But with rising surface temperatures, rain cycles are destabilized, leading to forest fires and flooding. If this trend continues in the Amazon, a deadly feedback loop could lead to the rainforest drying out and turning into a savanna. And once that happens, nothing can stop the entire ecosystem from collapsing. Beto Quesada is a world-renowned scientist who revealed groundbreaking research in 2015 that showed the Amazon has likely stopped taking in our CO2.
We feel, you know, this urge, this need to understand it before it's gone.
No matter what it sounds like, the Amazon is waving a white flag. I cannot take any more of your emissions.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much.
Today, Beto oversees scientists like Lainara Lugli, who's collecting data about how the Amazon's ancient soil is lacking crucial nutrients.
So here, especially in this part of the Amazon, the soils are very poor in terms of phosphorus and some cations like calcium. So it doesn't matter if we increase CO2 forever. The plants needed other resources to assimilate this carbon.
The irony is that Brazil's president, Jair Bolsonaro, wants to clear the Amazon to make room for agriculture like soy and beef.
With the soils we have here, you know, they are not suitable for agriculture. You know, sometimes I think people don't realize that, you know.
Beto's research group is studying how increasing CO2 levels in our atmosphere will affect the rainforest. The best computer model suggests that the Amazon will continue to trap excess CO2. But Beto has found inaccuracies in the models, which means it's not clear whether the Amazon will survive the increasing CO2. So now they need a large-scale experiment to get new data and adjust the model.
You know, when a country like Brazil has some financial problems, you know, science is usually the first thing that is cut.
But President Bolsonaro just slashed more than 40% of the Ministry of Science's annual budget.
We're heading out with a group of biologists who are trying to understand the nitty-gritty of how these trees interact with the atmosphere.
So beautiful, the...
Michelle Robin is a biologist who studies how trees are physically adapting to a CO2-rich world. CO2 is essentially plant food, but it's also what's warming our planet at an exponential rate.
So we see that we can have some groups of trees that have characteristics that allow them to grow faster. But this goes at the expense of them not having dense tissue for them to survive.
Let me see if I've got this. The increase of CO2 in the atmosphere, it gives mm-hmm. the trees a sort of a growth spurt. And mm-hmm. they grow tall, they grow fast, mm-hmm. but they don't grow sturdy. And that kind of thin growth spurt makes them vulnerable to diseases and insects
exactly,
and all different
yes.
kinds of things.
And also their wood is less dense, so if you have wind events or fires, they are also more vulnerable. So this is where we climb up to the walkway.
Right.
Michelle took me up into the forest canopy to where she does some of her most exciting research.
This is so badass.
But this breathtaking scene is vanishing.
What is your biggest concern when it comes to this rainforest from your perspective?
I think deforestation is my biggest concern. The rate at this is happening right now is really extreme. And we know that these trees, they can act as a sink of carbon. And once we cut them down, they become sources of carbon. They are storing a lot of carbon in their stems, in the soil, in their roots. And if we cut them down, we will release this all over again to the atmosphere.
We headed back to camp before sunset, where that evening, the scientists watched as Bolsonaro attacked deforestation data released by the country's space agency and started singling out scientists. The attack would have a chilling effect on our interview with Stefan the next day, as we climbed the tallest data tower, the Ato.
So the forest is emitting some gases, the forest is absorbing some gases, and we have the important point of recycling of rain, where the rainforest is responsible for a huge amount of precipitation which is occurring in South America.
Early on in the climb, Stefan spoke openly about the impact of deforestation, which Bolsonaro is encouraging more of in Brazil's Amazon.
If you would cut the forest away and we had a completely different ecosystem, it will be probably get a hotter ecosystem which would shift some global precipitation and wind patterns completely.
As we climbed, a storm approached.
It's quite a bit of rainfall around us.
Yes, in the east direction, and the cloud is growing a bit in the last minutes. And I'm just wondering if there is a chance that we get wet.
And then the storm blew in. Luckily, it changed direction, so we could resume our climb. But at the top, Stefan's tone shifted.
What are the drivers behind this deforestation belt?
This is a question which I will not respond because this is out of our research and this is too political and this is
too endangering right now, the situation.
The reason for Stefan's fear became clear just days later, when President Bolsonaro fired the head of Brazil's space agency, who had released data showing increased deforestation.
Do you feel, as a scientist, that you and your colleagues are getting the support that you need to better protect this rainforest?
This is not a question to answer.
Days later, Germany and Norway cut millions of dollars of environmental funding to Brazil. The funding was originally set up to reward Brazil's success at reducing deforestation, something that's clearly not happening anymore.
We have a serious situation right now, politically, that... I will not speak it by the camera, and I will not speak it in the microphone.
What was clear from our journey to the tallest heights of the Amazon was that it's all under threat, not just the rainforest, but also the science that could help steer us out of the climate crisis. The scientists here are sounding the distress call, but it doesn't feel like anyone's listening. Hey everyone, it's Guillory. Thank you so much for watching the final dispatch of Goodbye Earth from Brazil. It's been an intense journey, but such an honor to bring these stories to you. I'd love to know what kind of climate-related stories you want us to cover in the next series, so please leave a comment.